Hey friends, yesterday was SUNTUP release day, and you know what that does to old Beef Daddy's heart. Yeah, so, you know, as an admin on the Fans of SUNTUP unofficial page, etc., and so on, I interview people for these releases. It's what I do, it's my bag. And I had the absolute pleasure of interviewing John Langan. Just a great guy. We talked about all kinds of things, Bitcoin, our favorite purebred dogs, you know, the state of Southeast Asia. No, we didn't talk about any of those things. We talked about books, man. We talked about horror. We talked about Blackwater. So this originally appeared on the Fans of SUNTUP Facebook page. So that's why, that's all the context you really need, really. And then, you know, to understand, you know, what we're talking about. But I wanted to bring it out here for those of you who aren't on the Fans of SUNTUP Facebook page. And I think you should remedy that, but I'm not a dictator. I can't force you to yet. So until then, check it out here. And these copies, the artist editions are still available. So let's clear out that inventory, shall we? That's your job today. Clear out that inventory. And if you see there's any left, just keep buying. That's a joke. That's a joke. I'm not a shill, okay? I just want you to enjoy the books. You really only need one to enjoy it. But you buy two, you get that double stack card, and that's a collector's item that, you know, it's just fun to have. So anyway, get that. Saturday, the public sale will go live with whatever numbered editions are left. It's insanely gorgeous. That's all I'm going to say. And if you can, get in the lottery for the lettered edition. So anyway, that's neither here nor there. Check out John Langan. He's awesome. I'm humbled to talk to such a brilliant mind about the state of horror. Hope you enjoy it. And I know I'm going to go gout. I don't want gout. I'm going to go out and I'm going to buy The Fisherman by John Langan because it sounds like right in my sweet spot of horror. So check it out. Anyway. Stay frosty, as you will.
For once, I'm not talking to myself. It's time to go beyond the book and get over your shell.
All right, we're going to let John Langan in. So everybody, be on your best behavior. He's a professor. Hello, John. Are you there, John? It's me, Jeff. I hope you're there. There you are.
Here I am.
Hello. Hello. Yes, like I said, I have some questions for you. Because Paul told me about the book, and he gave me your contact info and Marcella a couple weeks ago, so then I did research. But what I don't like about doing research is that it leads to more research. And all that research produces is the knowledge that I don't know a damn thing. So that's what I come away from research with. But I looked into you, and according to your Wikipedia page, you're a finalist in the International Horror Guild Award. You're the nominee and winner of the Bram Stoker Award for The Fisherman, which I got to get that book based on my research. But then... and then you got your master's and now teach at SUNY New Paltz. And then you're a father, husband, and you have a body positivity cat at home. So that's...
Yeah, that's mostly up to date. I now teach at a private high school, at a boarding school. But yeah, I taught at New Paltz for, geez, about 20 years, I guess.
Oh, wow.
Mostly an adjunct there. And then... saw an opportunity in a boarding school and left there. My younger son's going to college, so you know you got to pay the bills somehow.
Right. You know, that's a shame because I was gonna become a student at SUNY New Paltz, and I already bought a place
still,
there.
You still should. You absolutely should. There are many fine teachers there.
So what I've also learned.
My wife teaches there.
Oh, okay. All right. So you're still...
So I sort of have to say that, you know.
So you're still local to upstate New York then? You didn't relocate?
Yep. No, okay, because no, I'm still mid Hudson Valley.
In my previous life as a higher ed marketer, I worked with a couple boarding schools. So I was going to ask you if you're working at Asheville or Culver, but I'm too young to get admitted to either of those schools.
You know, with time.
With time. Yeah. So anyway, but I also discovered you've written a ton of stuff, a lot of short fiction, and then with collections. So one thing that struck me with your collections, when you assemble those collections, do you write it a story at a time and then you discover a theme, or do you write with a theme in mind?
It's mostly I write a story at a time, and then I'm like, oh, okay, I think I have enough stories for a collection, and I put them together, and I'm like, oh, look at this. There was this one point in time where you were doing this particular thing, and I think, oh, wow, that's interesting. So like my I wrote a collection called Sephira and Other Betrayals, and I realized that I had written a few stories, this sort of like concentrated burst of stories that were really sort of obsessively working through these sort of themes of betrayal. And I had actually wanted to include a couple more stories that would make it into my fourth collection. I thought, oh, I'll include those here. But I was like, they don't work. They don't fit the theme. So I included those then in the fourth collection. And the fourth collection, which is the one that has been out most recently, which is called Children of the Fang. With that, I was like, I've got all these stories. I want to put them together. And I was like, well, this kind of grab bag thing. And then I saw that like a lot of them had been written for kind of themed anthology, specifically like sort of author tribute anthology. And I was like, oh, okay. So, you know, this is me in some ways responding to some of the people who are like in my family tree, if you will. So, you know, a lot of Stephen King, some Peter Straub, everybody was talking or has been talking about Lovecraft the last few years. So
yeah,
you know, he's in use. So, yeah, and my next collection, which I hope will be out sometime in November, is all stories that are more sort of autobiographically inspired.
Interesting. A quick note: we're getting a note that there's trouble hearing you. So if I don't know if you can speak louder or I'm hearing you just fine, but it is a little quiet.
Okay.
So that's interesting. And you mentioned the family tree and you mentioned Stephen King. And I saw in an interview you did with Nightmare Magazine that you talked about when you talk about what you write, you talk about when you talk about horror to the uninitiated, to the people who aren't familiar with nuances in horror, that they just kind of like, when you use that word, it's a speed bump. They're like, oh, what's horror? They think of slasher movies, or they think of, you know, the exploitative sort of gore fests. And then you just resolve to saying Stephen King stuff. And they're like, okay, Stephen King stuff. I can understand that. But that made me think, like, with somebody who not only writes it, but studies it and teaches creative writing, what do you think horror is? For me, horror is anything that weaponizes my brain against me. So anything that I read that makes me want, like, you know, imagine the worst, like Blair Witch Project was terrifying to me. The Lighthouse was terrifying to me. The Road, I would consider a horror book. So, but from your perspective, what is horror to you?
Sure. I think there were, like the really abstract answer that I give is that I see horror as fiction about those moments when, you know, the bottom falls from underneath you. And so the way that you understood the world and the workings of the world and maybe the workings of your own brain, it's revealed, it's not just insufficient, but it's maybe absent. And so it's this fiction where, you know, everything you thought you knew, or a lot of what you thought you knew, turns out to be wrong. And so that's, I think a lot of times people say that horror, I've heard people say that horror is about monsters. And I would kind of tweak that and say, horror is about the monstrous. as a kind of category. So you know, like a monster can be defined. You know, you can put it in your monster manual. Ultimately, oh, it has 25 hit points, and its armor class is this, that, and that. You know, whereas the monstrous, I think, is more of a kind of moving target. So that, you know, when Dracula shows up in Stoker's novel, or in Lefanu's Carmilla. When Carmilla shows up, these vampires are like they escape categorization or easy categorization. They're these creatures of appetite, of almost shapelessness. You know, they change so much, right? So they're monstrous. But when you get to, I think the vampires, an interview with the vampire, are monstrous. But when you get to maybe Queen of the Damned, say, thinking through the Rice series, that they've become monsters. So I don't know that they're necessarily, there might be individual ones who you could say, oh, that's monstrous. But they're more knowable, they're more, and they may be frightening. A monster can be super frightening. But I guess I'm thinking about almost a kind of the resonance that a monster has. Mm-hmm. And so a monster that is, Well, you know, I mean, just to take it to McDowell for a second in Blackwater, you know, Eleanor Dammert, the sort of central female figure in the novel. I don't know if you can quite call her the protagonist, but she certainly is at the center of the novel. She is monstrous, I think. But part of what makes her monstrous is that there are parts of her that are just unknowable, and she's constantly capable of surprising you. Maybe that's got something to do with it, you know, that in a good horror narrative, you are surprised in some way. So that and I know that, you know, that changes over time, right? Like when we read Dracula, we know the story. So that when Jonathan Harker goes to Transylvania and all this sort of stuff, and he meets this guy, this old guy, we're like, oh my God, he's a vampire. Look at all the clues, right? But if you can try to imagine that, you know, within the text itself, and at the time, this was like, oh my God, I thought he was just a foreigner, but on top of that, he's a vampire.
Right. You know, I think there's a couple of things you said there that I had to take note down. Because I totally agree. Your definition of horror is anything that upends your understanding of the world. And I immediately thought of Jaws and why that was such a horrible book. Our understanding of the world is that we are the top of the food chain. There's no natural predators to human beings other than human beings. And so other organisms pose us no threat. We take them out. But here, this shark is just devastating this town, not just per person, but the economy. And it really does upend your understanding of man's place in the world. But also, you said horror works on surprise. I heard the same thing, like horror and humor, both of them work on that, upending your expectations. And I think that's something Stephen King wrote about when he had Blaine in Dark Tower giving the riddles, and why a joke works is just that you're expecting one thing and you're almost shocked into laughter when the ending's different than you expected. So but yes, I do want to talk about Blackwater. Horror works best when it's focused on humanity, in my opinion. Yeah, you have to connect to the characters. You have to feel what they're feeling, for sure. And I think all good horror stories are driven by that. But I do want to talk about Blackwater. How does this fit into the horror? You talked about the pivotal main character or the central character figure being monstrous. But where does this fit? If you had to talk about, I know it's Southern Gothic, but where do you fitting in?
I think it remains kind of an underappreciated accomplishment in a lot of ways, right? I mean, you can fit it in, you know, McDowell is part of the generation of writers that includes Stephen King and Peter Straub, Ramsey Campbell on the other side of the pond. Charles Grant, to a certain extent, Ted Klein, and probably Anne Rice fits in there too. But anyway, writers who are kind of revamping the way that we write horror, and especially the way that we write horror novels. There have been horror novels before this, you know, if you think back over, I don't know, since Frankenstein, right? Even Frankenstein is a relatively short novel. Many, not all, but many of the great accomplishments in horror are in the sort of novella to short story form, right? But when you get to King and Straub, and writers who precede me, you know, Rosemary's Baby, IR-11, and Blatty's The Exorcist, the novel becomes this maybe the preeminent horror form in a lot of ways, or at least it becomes the form that a lot of horror writers say, huh, let's see what we can do with this. Let's see how far we can go with this. And so so what you get is this massive experimentation with the novel, which it's funny. I don't think a lot of people see it that way. I think a lot of people are just like, oh, whatever, pot boilers, you know. But they're actually Straub in things like Ghost Story and Shadowland and King, in much of what he writes. They're experimenting with how you can make horror work at novel length. And King gets, I mean, I think in Salem's Lot, King really he creates a kind of a template that I think a lot of people have used since then, which is to mash up Dracula and Peyton Place, his own description of it. So the novel of the kind of small town scandal combined with whatever the supernatural element is. And so those two things intersect one another, and you get almost a kind of a synergy that's happening, where all the sort of real world decay, if you will, the gossip, the betrayals, I guess, that you encounter in a small community, all of those get kind of reflected in the monster that shows up and of course prevents the community from interacting or you know, coming together really to stop the monster until it's too late, right? Mm-hmm. But for all that, I mean, what Straub does, you know, riffing on things on previous texts and something like Ghost Story, where he rewrites other stories and includes them in his story, you know, but both of those novels, I think Salem's Lot and Ghost Story, provide templates for a lot of what comes after. But one of the things that I think both of those novels do is they remain really focused on a kind of limited amount of time. So the events in both novels take place over a couple of months, maybe something like that. Now they deal with things, in the case of Ghost Story, they deal with things that happened a generation more, but still the kind of the time during which the novel takes place is kind of limited. You don't find a huge number of horror novels that take place over generations. The French have this term, the roman fleuve, the river novel, or the novel as river, and it's their kind of I think very lovely way of describing this sort of family saga. And this brings me to Michael McDowell. This is what McDowell does in Blackwater, is to write a family saga. So give us something that unfolds over time, over a generation, so that we get to see the horror, if you will, insinuating itself into the life of this community, and we get to see a particular family, the Kafka family, but we get to see that playing out over a length of time, and it's interesting that I don't think a lot of I was trying to think, actually, like what horror novels or novelists have picked up on what McDowell does. And I can't really think of a lot. Daryl Gregory, who's kind of horror adjacent, wrote a novel called Spoonbenders, which is about a family who have like sort of supernatural abilities, or maybe psychic abilities would be a better way to put it. And Daryl also wrote a novel called Raising Stony Mayhall, I think, which is about a kind of almost zombie family who are living in the aftermath of Romero's Night of the Living Dead. It's pretty crazy. But it's not something as a rule, I think it's not a kind of approach to the horror novel that a lot of people have embraced. And you know, fair enough, because King's example and empowering, he's so present in the culture, and he's had such a profound effect that it shouldn't come as a surprise that a lot of people would turn to his examples. But I do think that what McDowell is doing in Blackwater is in some ways very challenging. It's very challenging to try to map out the life of a family and to keep the monster interesting, I guess, in a way to enable her to interact with the rest of the family without just eating them all. You know, in vampire novels, right, the vampire just can't control him or herself and is just, you know, the family is just isn't going to last that long because the vampire is like, you look delicious. But I think that in Eleanor's case, she is able to control her appetites. But what she's after is a matter for discussion, I think. I think when you get to the end of this big book, there's still room to discuss, what was she after? What was she trying to do?
Interesting. You know, I think I searched for this book. I really wanted to read it before I talked to you, and I did not succeed. I'm a flawed human, so I didn't get the book. But based on what you're describing, the only book that kind of gets at that generational thing would be, and I think it's a book a lot of the people watching this interview right now would know, is Seed by Anya Allborn. It's I'm sure there are a lot of differences, but it's basically multi-generational. It's almost mental illness that's passed among the generations, passed down, but it manifests in a supernatural way. So it doesn't look like mental illness that we know, but it's interesting how that's the only comparison I could find, because
I know some of Anya's work, but I haven't read that one. I'll have to add that to the Seed, to the queue.
So that's one thing I do love about Anya's work. I'm reading Dark Across the Bay, her most recent book. I've read Brother and Seed, and it does. All these books so far, I haven't read her whole catalog, but they all operate on the family and the family unit and how we prize our family bonds, but sometimes those bonds are binding and they're constraining and they tie us to people that we shouldn't be tied to. That's a shorthand way to capture the three works that I've read, but it's interesting because I think, you know, it's such a spot of vulnerability for all of us, especially as you're a parent, you're a child, you're dependent on your parents. They are the entire world. If there's something wrong with them, you're in trouble. And then as a parent, you feel vulnerable. You have a whole bundle of nerve endings out in the world that you can't control, but you still feel what they feel in a way. So I think playing with that connection. Now I don't know how that plays out in Blackwater, but I do know Paul commissioned an artist to do a map and then a family tree. So I know family is an important thing.
Yeah, and you know, McDowell talked about that. I mean, you mentioned Southern Gothic before, you know, and that's such a in a lot of ways, I think that's such a big tent. Not unlike horror fiction, you know. I think that like what you can call horror. My wife and I watched Black Swan last night, which I'd never seen before, and we got done
with
Natalie Portman. Yep. And we got done, and I was like, man, that was a horror movie. That was absolutely a horror movie, you know. So I think horror is a big tent, but I think Southern Gothic is as well. And for me, when I think Southern Gothic, I tend to go right to Faulkner, and McDowell. I think McDowell mentions Eudora Welty, and he was a big fan of Eudora Welty, who was Faulkner's sort of slightly younger contemporary, right? But who was working, who was tilling the same soil, if you will, both literally in that she was from Mississippi and sort of figuratively, and that she too was interested in you know, call them family sagas or the way that, you know, it's funny, right? If you go back to so many of the novels in the 19th century, families present certainly, but not successive generations. It tends to focus on one generation. The other ones may be present, but there's it's about the struggle of of a particular generation or members of a particular generation to achieve or whatever it is, something. Whereas in the 20th century, again, I'm thinking about Faulkner here, both in individual novels like Absalom or The Sound of the Fury, but then also in his work as a whole, you get this family, community, place, they all become entwined with one another, so that family becomes a sort of vehicle of history, a vehicle of dysfunction as well, to use our terminology. But it's this living connection, and it's living in you. You know, it's not just that say your grandfather is still alive. It's that his actions and the way that he raised your mom, all of that affects you. All of that lives in you as well. So that you are, you know, I think people talk about the haunted South or something like that, and. That's a useful way to think about it. But I think it's that, you know, the people themselves are haunted. And I think that's one of the things that McDowell is really fascinated by is the way that the region is haunted, the way that the region is also subject to the town itself is located at the confluence of these two rivers, and it's at the mercy to a certain extent of nature, of natural forces. And Eleanor steps out of the water, so she's clearly connected to those things in some way. But McDowell, you know, the sort of cheap and trashy thing to do would have been to have said, she's like a Native American spirit. You know, he doesn't do that. He just says, no, we don't know what she is. She's just mysterious. And she, there are times when she transforms into something that seems kind of more reptilian. I it almost sounds more like the Gill Man in Creature from the Black Lagoon.
Yeah.
Except it has a tail. But so I don't think, you know, part of me at first I was like, is she like a were alligator or something like that? But I don't think so. I think she is some kind of you know, supernatural kind of creature that you just can't quite get a complete handle on. She's human life to her is it's important, you know, if it helps her get what she wants, but how do I put this? Getting what she wants may include killing. So like, you know, you're really important to me because I need to make a sacrifice out of you. You know, her perspective is really alien. McDowell said in talking about, I think it was his novel, The Elementals, he said that he thought that the supernatural should be kind of inexplicable. That it should just, like, we shouldn't be able to understand it. And he was an early fan of Asian horror cinema, Japanese and Chinese films. I haven't been able to track down exactly what films, but what he liked about them was the feeling, on the one hand, that the supernatural was just like another aspect of life that you didn't completely understand, maybe. It could just kind of intersect your life in these weird ways. And I think also if you've seen, you know, the original Ring movies, let's say, at least for me, you know that they're part of what makes them, I think, so effective for a Western audience is if you don't understand Japanese culture, you know that, okay, things are happening that probably make sense if you live in Japan. You know, you if you've been raised in Japanese culture, you look at these things and you're like, okay,
yeah,
I that's a reference to this. But if you're not from that culture, it just seems very odd and very mysterious. There's a wonderful scene, I think it's in the second Ring movie, where one of the characters sees three ghosts and they're all just turned away from him, and they're under an overpass too, and that is deeply disturbing. And I'm sure that there is some at least I think that there's some cultural significance to that. But for me, that's just so weird. That's so,
yes.
That's not what I expect a ghost to do, right? So
I
think that McDowell probably got some of that. And I think that probably informs Blackwater to a certain extent. I think he learned that you can make the supernatural inscrutable in some ways. You don't have to have the Van Helsing figure who shows up and says, okay, you know, we need garlic, we need holy water,
yeah,
we need wooden stakes.
You know, I think that to me is the best horror works like that. It works, it doesn't reveal itself. If you think of cosmic horror, and you think of Lovecraft, who the old ones, like, they predate man, and they have this dominion that we can't even fathom. And, you know, the best books, period, don't give it all away. They allow you to unpack it. They allow you to extrapolate, to interpret. Like, I think there are a few people, and I know he's a friend of yours, Paul Tremblay. There are a few people that kind of balk, not many, but a few people that balk at the endings of his books. So I've read two, Cabin and Head Full of Ghosts. For me, I love it. I love it. I love when, I don't want to spoil anything, because I'm particularly talking about the end of the books. But what Paul does so well is he lays out the evidence for either conclusion. You could believe whatever you want. You could believe this was a supernatural event. You could believe this was mental illness. You could believe this was just a random hostage crime from a crazy cult. Whatever you want to believe, he gives you evidence to back up whatever you want. And that puts you're a participant then. You're more invested in the story. And therefore it's more horrific, because there are no, that's the worst thing. The most terrifying thing is the unknown. The thing that humans can't grasp is the thing. I mean, look at COVID, look at, you know, anything that is sort of fast moving. And, you know, I don't know. I just think that, to me, the best horror doesn't give it all away. So I don't want to know if there's a, I want to be able to interpret this central figure in Blackwater. So that excites me. I know there are a lot of people that like it all spelled out for them.
Yeah. No, I think you're right, though. I mean, look, I think of books like food. Sometimes I want a Big Mac. A Big Mac can be very satisfying, yeah, in the right circumstances. Yeah. I know exactly what I'm getting with a Big Mac. It will never get any better. I don't look back and I don't think, that was a Big Mac. You know, I'm just like, but it also won't get any worse, you know, so at least you hope, right? So I think that there are narratives, movies, whatever, you know, books that are kind of like that, where, yeah, you sort of know everything, you know, you're not really going to be surprised, you know, you're just, and that's, that comfort is what, the comfort of the familiar is what you want. I just don't know that when you go back to it, let's say, I don't know that you're going to find anything new in it. I don't know. It's more just what you're going to find in it is what you expected to find in it. It's the familiar. But then I think about, you know, there were meals I've had, let's say, that friends cooked or in a nice restaurant or something that I still remember. I'm like, oh man, that was great.
Yeah.
And I can, you know, whatever, mentally revisit that and think, wow, that was really terrific. And I think that there are books like that too, that you can go back to and find something new in it. You can continue to appreciate it. I think, you know, and I mean, I'm drawing on like a bunch of different literary critics here and novelists, people like Italo Calvino and Vladimir Nabokov, who talked about the way that literature, like the literary, that kind of vexed term, is the thing that kind of keeps talking to you. It keeps speaking to you, whatever. So every time I go back to Ghost Story or Peter Straub's other stuff, that he's got something new to say to me. And I love that. I love that sense that this book and I are in this ongoing conversation. And that my conversation with it now, yeah, to a certain extent, is kind of influenced by previous conversations with it and conversations that other people have had with it too, where someone has said, did you notice Peter does this in Ghost Story? And I thought, no, I didn't. And, you know, so I think that that I hey, if all you want, and it sounds so snide, right? And I don't mean to be snide,
right,
but
right.
If comfort food is your thing, then that's totally fine. If that's what you need literature for, then there's nothing wrong with that. But I think for me, there is something really exciting about that idea of a book that keeps talking to you, that you can continue to have a conversation with. So, and I think Blackwater fits that.
And I'm in the camp where I don't believe in the term guilty pleasure. Unless you're doing something illegal, then yes, by all means, you're guilty. But in the sense of guilty pleasure, like, don't feel guilty. If you're a metalhead and you want to listen to Kesha, listen to Kesha. I mean, if that's what you want, you know, whatever. Like, there shouldn't be a guilty pleasure in something you connect with on any level. But I also love your definition of what that there's that Big Mac, but then there's that meal you remember. And for me, that book, and I know people in this group are sick of me talking about it, is Butcher Boy. And when I read that, it's a novel by Patrick McCabe.
Right. Yeah.
When I read that book, the first time I read it, I was a younger man, and I thought, boy, this kid screwed up. What a nutbag. This kid's got all these problems, and, you know, I like it. I love the story. He's an unreliable narrator, and wow, this is a great book. I read it as a little more of a mature, possibly after I became a father, and I thought, oh my God, this kid's a victim. He's traumatized. He's devastated. Look what this family upbringing did to this poor kid. I mean, and right, you go back to it, and through your own personal evolution and growth as a human being, you discover new things that you were blind to before, because your brain probably wasn't as open, or as informed, or whatever, you know, experience shapes you. And I think that's a great way to look at it. You know, Stephen King did say his books were the literary equivalent of a Big Mac with fries. And I hated it when I heard him say that. Yeah, I hated it.
It's defensive, isn't it? It's like a defense mechanism.
It kind of is.
Say, you know, like I'm not like those. But of course, you know, what you've noticed the last 20 years is that he's become, he doesn't say that anymore. You know,
no.
he's become a lot more concerned about his sort of literary reputation, and he doesn't want people to think he was, I mean, I get it. I think the original purpose of the comparison was to try to say, I'm humble. I mean, McDowell had a sort of similar problem in that he originally presented himself, and it might've been in the Faces of Fear interview he did with Doug Winter. He presented himself as just, hey, you know, I'm a craftsman. I get it done, baby. If you call me up and you're like, we need a novel about underwater Nazi cheerleaders, I'll do it, you know? And that, as with King, that kind of comparison sort of, it bit him a bit. And he, in a later interview, I'm trying to think of, might've been one of his, there's a big interview he did with Fangoria, I think it was. But anyway, he said, you know, look, that doesn't mean that I don't care about what I do. And that doesn't mean like to say I'm a craftsman doesn't mean I'm crafting junk. It just means that I see myself as trying to work and get stuff done. And I think it's the same thing with King, that in both cases, I think they were positioning themselves against what they saw as a kind of overly highbrow, up my own butt kind of, I'm going to take a million years to finish a novel kind of mentality. I think they wanted to present themselves in a humbler kind of way, but I think that, you know, whatever you say will be used against you, right?
Right.
And so I think in both cases that allowed people to dismiss them and to say, well, King himself says he's just a Big Mac. McDowell himself says, you know, so I think that's be careful how you describe yourself, you know?
Yeah, especially with such a long career as King's had, you know? And I think when he transferred to Scribner and he was doing he did Bag of Bones, which was his sort of trying to start to reclaim that, you know, literary vibe. Yeah, no, I think it's interesting because, I'm going to, you're asking me to do a book about underwater Nazi cheerleaders, but I'm going to make you care about what they do and who they affect, right. And, you know, right. And it's funny because Stephen King made me, and Tommyknockers made me terrified of a vending machine. I mean,
right,
like,
right. The malevolent vending machine. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, it's so outrageous. And that book gets panned all the time and I don't agree with it, but you know, I think it's what you do and how you get somebody to see a vending machine a different way, how you get somebody to realize, well, underwater Nazi cheerleaders are a threat. You know, that's the brilliance of the author, of somebody who can bring that and make it something that impacts you, because there are some authors.
Yeah, it's all in the execution, right? I mean, that's Henry James used to have this, you know, he would talk about having, you know, ideas or picking up, like he would take notes he used to love to go to dinner parties. And of course people would tell him stories and he would write down the, you know, this is, told me about this. And he would say, maybe I can treat this. And, you know, he thought about it and I'm not sure what he was like, treat it in what, like what was the metaphor, you know, what was he, but in any event, like it's your imagination that is going to make something good or bad, you know, like there's no great idea or bad idea for that matter. I mean, now maybe there's a few, but anyway, but I think that it all has to do with what you bring to it. And of course, you know, what happens if you're a horror fan, it's you know, probably if you're a romance fan too, come to think of it, because they are often the most reviled genres
right
at this point, you know, is there's this this blanket view that these are just not worthy subjects, you know, that it's just that they're not, and you know, that's ridiculous in both cases. Yeah, there's just, I think about all those sorts of fringe, whether, you know, music, you know, take your pick, whatever gets dismissed. You mentioned metal before, right? And metal often gets dismissed. It all depends on the band, right? It all depends on who's doing it. And that's the same thing with fiction. It depends on who's doing it. There are great writers writing horror fiction, and there are terrible writers writing horror fiction.
Yes.
And there are great writers writing realist fiction, and there are terrible writers writing like the what you're writing has nothing, or I say nothing, but little to do with how good or bad something is. It's what you do with it.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. Do you think movies, like, you know, you talked about, you know, the one thing that sat with me in the interview you did was when you talked about fit horror. And, you know, because I describe, when somebody asks where I live in Oaklawn, Illinois. But when somebody asks where I live, I just say Chicago, because that's easier for them to understand. So you say, I write Stephen King stuff. And, but do you think movies in studios like A24 and movies like The Babadook or The Lighthouse or It Follows, and books like The Grip of It, or other, you know, House of Leaves, do you think these books and movies are changing the opinion, or is it just so small that you just have to be somebody who lives in Chicago to know about Oaklawn, and you have to be somebody who reads horror fiction to know about the more literary horror?
Oh man, I don't know. You know, I wish it were changing. Maybe it is. I mean. A lot of the writers, you know, like Michael Chabon, say, who won the Pulitzer Prize a few years ago for The Adventures of Cavalier and Clay, and who's this very respected literary figure, credits Stephen King as one of his major influences. And you've seen more of that. You have seen more writers who are working in, I guess, what we would think of as a literary mainstream, but who are... who maybe have genre elements in their work or seem to be sort of genre friendly, you'll find a lot of them mentioning King, right? In particular. So I think that maybe there's some slight shift in that direction. And yeah, you know, I subscribed to Shudder a few months ago, the streaming channel, and it was one of my best investments ever.
Really?
One of the things I love about Shudder is just the variety of horror films that are on there. I feel kind of like you know, obviously we're living in the age of superhero movies, right? And I'm in there with everybody else. I saw Suicide Squad opening night, you know.
Yeah.
Streaming to be safe, but anyway. Whereas superhero movies do start to feel the same, you know, they do start to feel like, oh, here we go, you know, right? And there were, you know, obviously there were exceptions and all this kind of stuff, but with horror films, man, the range of what people are doing, and often on very constricted budgets, it's just amazing to me, you know. And so like you know, someone like Josh Rubin, who did Scare Me and Wolves Within, Werewolves Within, I think something, Werewolves Within, I think. You know, he's doing this kind of horror comedy stuff. And then you mentioned the Babadook. A24 has really they've done just a lot of really innovative work kind of all over the place, but especially the horror stuff, I think, has been really great. So on the one hand, I want to give a shout out to all those independent filmmakers, you know, like Phil Gillette, who did the adaptation of Laird Barron's story 30, a movie called They Remain, which I think is coming to Shudder, if it's not on, and I actually think it might be on it, which is a terrific weird movie. That there are just so many great, like offbeat wild horror movies out there for all tastes, or for someone who wants who like, you know, if you want to go very violent, there's very violent, and if you want to go very weird, there's very weird and subtle. I love that about horror film. Having said all that, I think that for a lot of the kind of mainstream audience, I think it is still associated with like the Saw movies. And no harm to the Saw movies necessarily.
No, right.
But I mean, you know, like sort of slasher films, I think that the majority of moviegoers and of the larger mainstream audience, I don't think they look at like Ben Wheatley's movies, the Field in England or something like that. I don't think that, I can't remember the name of his new one, but I don't think they're particularly, they don't see that as horror. What they see as horror is a lot of death, and it better be messy and you know, so in the same way, I'm sure there were great, great romantic films, but most of us, we think of, oh, it's another rom-com with J-Lo or something like that.
Right, you know? Right.
No harm to J-Lo. But
no, I mean, The Lighthouse seriously messed me up. That movie messed me up for a couple of days. So, but you know, it's interesting. I don't know if this is fake news, but I heard that Steinbeck wrote a werewolf novel, and the estate's trying to keep it on ice. And I mean, that I think is huge. And it's interesting to think of how somebody is well regarded and renowned would tread into that territory.
Yeah, Faulkner wrote a script for a vampire movie when he was working in Hollywood. In the past, right? I mean, Henry James writes a bunch of ghost stories. So does Edith Wharton. These writers who were known as great sort of realist or naturalist writers, they were fascinated by this stuff. And I think that every now and again, I mean, Michael Chabon's done more stuff recently with sort of genre friendly stuff, but even in his earlier books of short stories, each book had like a weird story in it. So I think that the form, the sort of supernatural story, has always been of interest. It's always been a kind of a challenge, right, for a writer. Mm-hmm. What if I did this? You know, what the heck? I would love to see the Steinbeck book. I would absolutely love to see it. And I think for his estate, probably the question is going to be, how much money is it going to make for us?
And what's the damage to the legacy?
Yeah, is there a damage to the legacy, or can we find, I mean, if I were Steinbeck's whatever administrators, the administrators of the estate, I would find a couple of big scholars who can write about the book in a way to place it within his career and blah, 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 and then I would release it and let the money roll in.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think you there's a certain sense of, there's a certain level you achieve in your career where nothing should be off limits. Like we need to see this book. Like it's almost obligatory. Like the culture sort of demands to see this book. And you know, I mean, nobody could say that because it's a private family, a private, you know, enterprise. But yeah, I think that is something we should explore and examine and find worth or discard it. But you know, one thing that you also said in one of your interviews, which I think goes along with this, is the freedom that small press brings to experimentation and horror. Because, you know, just like with the movies on Shudder, you're going to have gore, you're going to have slasher films. Films don't offer a lot of room for nuance. I mean, you really need to be a very skilled filmmaker to really get across nuance. You have to have a brilliant acting. A lot of things depend on that. So the easier thing to do is visual, you know, explosions and things that are a lot easier to grasp. And I'm not discounting the filmmakers that do bring nuance, but books allow that. And I think the small press and, you know, what SUNTUP brings to it, I think allows more expression. And for me, it's made me aware of other artists. But what do you think small press does for not just the books they publish, but for the whole written word, all of books?
Well, I think at this point in time, they're shouldering a tremendous, I was going to say burden, but what I mean by that is you've seen in mainstream publishing over the last maybe 20, maybe 30 years, you've seen, I think, two things. You've seen a consolidation of the major publishing houses. I think we're down to five at this point. And you've also seen as they've consolidated, you've seen major publishing, and this is the same thing with movies, actually. You've seen them become very, very risk averse. And so they are not interested in taking a chance on anything. And will there be one book they take a chance on? Sure. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, and so they can say, look, we took a chance on Langan's new novel, right?
Yeah.
But for every novel they take a chance on, there's 100, there's 200, there's 300 that they're just like, no. And so what you've had is, in the case of films, right, we see this, the tentpole franchises, right? Oh, we're going to have another Star Wars movie. We're going to have another Marvel movie, because these are the movies that are a sure thing. You know, even if your Star Wars movie tanks, quote unquote, at the box office, it's still going to bring in, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars. And even if your Stephen King novel, quote unquote, tanks, and I'm not picking on King, it's still going to bring in, you know, again, hundreds of millions of dollars. And so because they become so risk averse, it means that what used to be called the mid-list, those group of writers who were decent sellers, maybe sometimes even very good sellers, but weren't necessarily going to be for everyone, you know, they've really been squeezed out. And so what mm-hmm. you have in major publishing now, and to a certain extent the same thing in major film, is you have, you know, the giant marquee names, they have a place, and then there's also a place for the trophy writers, the writers who win Nobel prizes for literature or Pulitzer prizes. The publishing companies keep publishing them so they can say, oh, look, but you know, we're doing our cultural duty,
right?
And in the meantime, the writers who are in the middle have a much harder time. They really have gotten squeezed out. And so the small press has really, or independent publishers, if you prefer, they've really picked up a lot of the slack that way. And I think they've done maybe at least two important services. One is that they serve as a venue for voices that are in some way off the beaten path. to find a larger audience. And that's hugely important. The other thing I think they do is they help to keep works, previous works in print. I can never remember the name of the act, but however many years ago, the Supreme Court ruled that you could tax, I think it was like stock. And this affected publishing companies. They didn't keep a lot of back stock. They pulped a lot of it because they could be taxed on it. So what this is that books go, especially books that don't sell particularly well, they can go out of print very quickly. They can disappear very, very quickly. And so on the one hand, you know, it's funny because we talk sometimes about how the writers of the past are, you know, they almost sort of hang over us. They lord it over us. They tyrannize us, you know, but there's a part of me that thinks, man, it is so easy for a writer to be forgotten. It is so easy for them to slip out of memory. And that's a kind of a frightening thought, especially when you read someone like Michael McDowell say, and you think, man, this is really good stuff. This is way ahead of its time in some ways. You know, why is no one talking about this? And you realize, well, no one's talking about it because it's slipped out of print. So I think that one of the things the small press has done is to make these kinds of works available to people, in editions that are going to last, which is, you know, that's another part of it, right? You know, I mean, some of the paperbacks I have they're looking a little the worse for wear.
Right.
I love them, you know, but they're wrapped in rubber bands or whatever, right, to keep them, maintain their integrity. And so I do think, you know, having a nice edition, the acid-free paper, all that kind of stuff is also another way to ensure that these things are going to endure.
Well, not only that, so like what I've noticed, SUNTUP does an edition. It brings a lot of attention to that author. Other people could see, you know, other business-minded folks can see, all right, well, there's an opportunity here. It stirs up the water, not just for what SUNTUP is selling, but also for what other people find worthy, and then back catalogs and other things like that. You know, you could see, I know Folio Society in England, in the UK, is also has kind of tailored their new catalog. I think they've done a lot of stuff that SUNTUP has done. And, you know, I'm not picking on them. They might have had things in the works while SUNTUP did as well. But it just creates this energy that does spill over into the whole rest of publishing. And I think being introduced, I remember William Peter Blatty's Legion, the sequel to The Exorcist, was out of print. I think it's still out of print. And, you know, Cemetery Dance did an edition. They brought it back. But that was a great book. And I've always, how do you create a book that becomes such a piece of the cultural DNA, and then the sequel goes out of print? It's sort of mind-blowing, the measure that publishers are willing to just abandon.
You would think, right, that because The Exorcist is so successful and is still in print, you would think that would keep Blatty's other work in print, right?
Right.
At least in like an omnibus edition or something like that. You would think that, but there's, to my mind, I guess, it does show how insane mainstream publishing has become in a lot of ways, in that there's this feeling that there's just not enough oxygen in the room, you know, and if we give Legion some oxygen, then it's going to take it away from The Exorcist or something like that. I don't know. I tend to pick on marketing departments in mainstream publishing, and it's because I myself and a number of my friends have had experiences where, you know, an editor maybe likes something that you've done, and then the marketing department says, nope, we can't sell this. And I think, but
right,
that's your job. You know?
Right.
Like the card is not supposed to be pulling the horse, you know, like,
right.
I think that, And you know, I have to be fair and say that at the same time, Penguin has done recently, they brought out, you're mentioning William Peter Blatty, they brought out Ray Russell's The Case Against Satan, and they did an edition of Thomas Ligotti's stories. So there have been some publishers who are actually trying to do kind of interesting things and things that are a little bit less than just purely commercially minded.
Well, I appreciate you sitting down and chatting with us today about this. It's been a great, I mean, I feel like I have just gotten such an education, first researching you and now talking to you. I love the discussion about these books and stories, and I'm going to go out and get a copy of The Fisherman, Fisherman. I keep saying Fishermen.
Thank you, because you know, my kid's going to college, and every book helps, man. Every book
helps. Bill, I was talking to Chris about how we pick out books and where we look at reviews. And I always go to Goodreads to look at reviews because Amazon isn't Amazon. It's important to have reviews on Amazon to sell books. That's fine, and it is important. But when I wanted to learn about the story and not just the transaction, I go to Goodreads. So I always go to the negatives. And I did look into The Fisherman. And when I read the negatives, I dismissed them because I realized the criticisms and the problems anybody had with the book. I don't share that thinking. So it helps me to understand, okay, well, these people very legitimately, you can't say an opinion's wrong. They didn't connect with the work, but I don't agree with their criticisms. The criticism doesn't sound like anything. Everything I've read about that book has me jazzed to read it. So I'm very much looking forward to it. I'm so glad to this ripple effect of learning about authors and then learning about others and really opening my mind, because for a long time, all I ever read was Stephen King, Clive Barker, and Ray Bradbury. That was like decades.
Yeah, no, those are great choices. But I think, you mentioned Paul Tremblay. I see you've got Josh Malerman on the shelf behind you.
Yeah.
You know, there are so many writers right now. And in part, you know, a lot of whom have started in my case, really largely remained within the small press. But there are so many writers right now who are doing just, you know, amazing work. Stephen Graham Jones, Sylvia Moreno-Garcia, Laird Barron, it really seems to me like we are living in some kind of, you know, is it a golden age? I guess we'll only know in retrospect, but
right.
It's certainly a really good time to be reading horror.
Yeah, there's a lot of great energy. Anya Allborn's another one who's really stepped into it, and there's a lot of great stuff out there, and it really gets me excited. Yeah, I have a lot of Josh Malerman because the man has an imagination that an entire world, I mean, universe can live there. Like, I just want to move into his imagination and hang out for forever. I mean, so I appreciate you taking this time. It's always great. Stick around the Facebook page and see how the fans react. It's a fun time. These next 2 days are always exciting on this page when a new book is released and everybody devours it with their eyes, regurgitates it with their words, and enjoys it. So thank you so much, and
thank you
and we will see you around.
Okay, take care.
All right, thank you. All right, bye.